Let's talk about reporting and documentation. By now you know that the GraphQL user interface is a great way of setting up your model, exploring it, sharing it with other people. In other words, it's great to support the creative process. But at a certain moment, you have your model, it's finished, you're happy, and you need to document it. You need to report it in such a way that other people are convinced that the model that you made reflects reality. Ideally, you would print out your whole model and somebody else would go over it with a yellow marker and just yellow line all the numbers to make sure that they are correct. The problem with GraphQL user interfaces is that they are very good at generating a lot of data in a very short time. Let me give you an example. Suppose you want to model a beam, a simple beam with two ends. So you go to your finite elements program, you enter the two endpoints, A and B, and you create a beam between those two endpoints. Then you refine your mesh. So you say, hey, I want to subdivide my beam into 100 nodes. And then you export your model to, or your model data to a file for somebody to check. What you get are 100 nodes, 99 segments, while the input of your model was only 2 nodes, 1 segment, and 1 action. Now, asking somebody to check whether all those 100 nodes and 99 segments are actually at the correct position is not a very nice thing to do. You can make somebody's life very, very difficult, very miserable. So what you actually want to do is you want to document what your input was and what you did with that input. So you want to document those 2 nodes, at 1 segment, and at 1 action. So how do we do that? Well, there's a couple of ways. First of all, you could just record your desktop while you're doing it. Just make a video of what you did. Another way is to, while you are doing the work, create screenshots of the GraphQL user interface and copy paste those into a Word report and then add some additional text explaining what you did and why. The third and nicer option is to actually sit together with somebody and do the work together. Then you have an independent person who's actually checking your work while you are doing it. A fourth option is let that checker make the same model and then compare the outcomes. But there's another option. And that's an option that is used a lot these days in computer science and data science. And that option is to program your workflow and to document it using a notebook. And a notebook is basically a mix of images, text, and computer code. And that may sound scary or difficult because it means that you would have to write computer code. But actually, Dave greatly facilitates in that. So let me show you how we would do that. Before I can continue, I need to explain in a little bit more detail what Dave actually is. Because as you may have noticed, Dave is not a single standalone program. Dave is a framework. And a framework is a number of building blocks or components that you can use to build a product. So, which components do we have? At the base of all the beauty, we have the Equilibrium Core. Equilibrium Core. This is the commercial part of Dave that takes care of all the geometry, force calculations, and the solving of the equilibrium what a word. On top of the Equilibrium core, we have the open source part. It starts with the API layer. API stands for Application Programming Interface, and it interfaces with the commercial core, and it contains the scene object. And as we know, a scene in Dave is actually the world that all the nodes live in. So all the nodes are in the API as well. And it also contains functionality to organize it, save it, load it, etc. Actually, all the basic actions that you can do with Dave are contained in the API. On top of that, there are sometimes groups of actions that you want to do on the scene. For example, a stability calculation or a static stability calculation for a vessel, hydrostatic stability calculations. And for that, we have plugins or tools. So we have the marine tool for the stability. We also have the goalseek function. There is the export to Blender. And what all these plugins or items do is they communicate with the scene and they adjust data in it, or they take data from it and export it. So they interact with your base model. Then the graphical user interface. The GUI, as we call it, stands completely separate from the base. In fact, the graphical user interface, all it does is when you push a button or you enter a text, it will generate some Python code and it will feed that code to the core. The core then does something with that code, and when it's done doing that, the result is fed back to the graphical user interface, which shows it to you. So you are here in this case. You have a big smile, of course, because you're, well, obviously you're using Dave and you like it a lot. So that's for the GUI. So you interact with the GUI. The GUI interacts via Python with Dave, and the result from Dave is communicated back to the graphical user interface, which presents it to you, which makes you smile. That's basically it. On the other hand, or on the other side, with a different color, what we can also do is not use the GUI, but use a notebook. And this works in exactly the same way as the graphical user interface. So we have a notebook. You are here. For some reason you have three legs, I don't know why. A notebook. You use the notebook to enter some Python code. That Python code is fed to the Dave core, it's executed, and the result is printed in your notebook as a result of your next cell. It can be a text, it can be a figure, a graphic, whatever. So this is Python, which you need to type. Sounds difficult, it is not, because the Python code that we have here happens to be exactly the same Python code as we have here in the graphical user interface. So if you're a beginner and you have no idea what kind of Python code to type, you just open up the graphical user interface, you change the properties, or you push the button that you want to push, you look at the Python code that the GUI generates, you just copy paste it to your notebook, and it works. It's exactly the same Python code. It's just the same process being executed from a different front end. Let me show you what this means. So just like in the schematic, on the left side I've opened the graphical user interface, and on the right side I've opened my notebook. The only difference from the schematic is that they are both connected to their own core. So this is the core that the GraphQL user interface is connected to, and this is the core that the notebook is connected to. So if I make a change in the notebook, it will not be visible in the user interface and the other way around. So we have a blank notebook and we have a blank scene. The first thing I want to do is I want to add an access system. So I right click, I say new access, give it a name, demo, press enter, and it has created a new access system. It also shows the Python code that was executed in order to create this access system. So I can just copy paste this Python code to the notebook. However, I did lie a little bit, because the first thing I need to do is import Dave. And I'm going to do that as follows: from Dave import star, which means from the Dave package import everything, which imports the Dave core. And then I'm going to create an empty scene. And by default, we will call that S. And now I can actually copy paste this code into my notebook. So I will do that. I say copy. We do paste. And if I hit shift enter to execute the cell, it will create a new access. Well, if I change the position of the access and I rotate it a little bit, so I change it to here and I rotate it about the Y axis. We can see here that whenever I change one of the numbers, it immediately generates some Python code. So to change the position, it generated this code. Well, first this one when I change it to 1, then this code when I change it to 2, and then this code. So I only need this one, because it doesn't make sense to first change it to 1, then to 2, and then to 3. And for the rotation, it's the same. First to 5, then to 10, then to 15. So I only need the last line. Copy it, paste it here. So this is actually quite readable Python code. I mean, it just says from the element or the node with the name demo, change the position to 300. And from that same node, so scene S, node demo property rotation, change that to 0.15.0. Okay, so far so good. Let's place a point of interest on that access system. So select create point of interest or point. Okay, place it on, well, let's place on 0.10 in the vertical axis. Another way to copy nodes is just to right click on them. So I right click on my point and I say copy Python code. If I paste that here, it will just do all of this in one line. So it says scene, so my world, executes the new point function to make a point with the name POI, place it on the parent demo, which is the name of the access system, and place it at position 0.0.10. Shift enter, it just works. So how to get results from this point? Well, for example, I want to know from this point of interest where the global X location is. So that is GX. So I have my point of interest selected. I look at the properties. There's one that's called GX. And the value is 5.588. What I can do is I can just drag and drop it from here to the notebook, and if I press shift enter, it just gives me the value. And in this case, it's a scalar, so it's a single number. I can also use a vector, and I get that. Well, this is still all pretty boring, because it's not really documented. So what notebooks can do is these are called cells, and these are called code cells, because they contain code. What's also possible is to
change the cell type to markdown. And markdown is basically text. So now it doesn't. Now this cell doesn't contain code, but this contains text. And it doesn't need to be plain text. It can be headings as well, or it can be bold. It can even contain pictures. So if I do a print screen, for example, one of the source reference documents that I have, and well, let's just get this screenshot and I paste it in here, it will just include the picture. So basically, all the actions that you can do in the graphical user interface, you can also do in the notebook environment. For something a bit more complicated, I will clear the scene, new. So it says s.clear. Basically throws away everything that you have in your world. So I will import the cheetah, my favorite vessel, with crane. Again, this only generates one line of code. Basically just says import the cheetah. So it says s.import scene, get resource, then the name, and we don't put it in a container and don't place any prefix on it. So now, for example, if I want to do a stability analysis, I go to stability, cheetah, displacements. Well, let's just say I want the default options and I want a displacement driven curve. I click it, I get the displacement driven curve, but I also get the code to do that. That is this part. So if I copy paste this to my workbook, press shift enter, it will run, it will give us some output, but it will also give us the graph in the report. And once you have this, you basically have your the actions that you took to generate your model. You have the data that you entered. You can annotate or document the data using text and figures. And you have all the results, either graphs or numbers, that you want to have in your report. So this is basically a complete collection of your input and your actions and your results. And once you have this, you can just export it to whatever format you like. You can export it as PDF, as Markdown, as HTML, as slides, as well, basically anything you want. The easiest is just to export it to HTML and then copy-paste the output into, for example, Word. Another cool thing that we have, let's say we only have the JupyterLab interface, and we want to see what we are working with. There are some tools in the JupyterLab package of Dave. So we can do from dave.jupyter import star. And there's a function called view, which we present the argument as. And if you run that, then we get a 3D visual of the scene that we have at that moment. It's an interactive 3D visual, as you see. So we can use this to explore. What we can also do is we can use the show command. And that will actually render a static screenshot of what we have. And in this case, the camera is a bit too close to the vessel. So what we can also do is we can activate the graphical user interface from the notebook. So I can say from dave.gui import star. So I'm now importing the GUI package. And then I am saying GUI S. And what it will now do, it will create the graphical user interface. But instead of connecting it to a separate core, it is connected to the same core as the notebook. So what we are seeing here is exactly the same model, or is physically the same model as the model that we are working with in the notebook. And what it also does is it freezes the notebook. So it's executing this cell, and there's a little asterisk here in front, meaning it's busy executing. So we can't do anything else here in the notebook at the moment until we close the graphical user interface. What I wanted to show is I can put the camera at a nice place. I can set up the view as I want. So maybe I want to get rid of the COGs. And then look from here. Then there's a little button over here, which means copy. And that actually copies the code that we need to generate the picture in the GUI here in a notebook. So if I close the GUI, get back to the notebook, I copy paste this code, and I can just put it here, and then when I run it, we get exactly the same picture as the picture that we had in the GUI. So we can also include screenshots or views from the model that we have at that moment in the report. Once you have a notebook like this, and something changes, you can just change it here and then rerun everything, and it will just re-execute all the actions that you took. So you don't have to manually update all the numbers. You only need to change the inputs that we changed, and then everything else will be updated again when you run it. So for example, if the COG of the vessel would have been changed, then here I could have changed the COG position of the vessel, and then once the stability curve is run again, it will automatically be updated to reflect that new COG position. Okay, it's easy to tell a lot about this, but as always, I try to keep these videos reasonably short. I never succeed. There's simply too much to tell. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope I was able to make things clear. If not, then just let me know what was unclear, and I will just take my time to explain it again. For now, please have fun with Dave, play around with it, get to know it. It's really a great tool to use. And in the meantime, when using these notebooks, you also pick up some Python skills. Thanks for watching. See you next time.